We just met, and already I'm like, oh my gosh, I have so many things in common with him. We're like kindred spirits. And the cool part about connection is it doesn't take that much to all of a sudden realize that another human being and you could be like, you could be friends, and it just takes a moment and a choice. So you guys, I want you to give your undivided attention all the way from the great island of Hawaii. Yeah. Kyle Kilau Singh.
Thank you so much, my man.
Yeah. Aloha, everybody.
My name is Kyle Kilau Singh from beautiful Hawaii. And yesterday was my son's birthday. His name is Grayson, and he just turned 4. So I was watching his birthday on FaceTime, and I was sad. But I'm happy I'm here today. So whoever went to Hawaii?
All right, a lot of you.
Okay, put your guys' hands down. So in Hawaii, for those that are not familiar with Hawaii, we greet each other with this. This is just called shaka. So I came a long way to be here today. So I'm gonna ask you folks if you guys can pull one shaka high in the air for me. And when I say aloha, at the top of your lungs, say aloha back. Okay, guys, ready? Aloha!
Aloha!
One more time. Aloha!
Aloha!
All right. I'm very grateful and honored to be here today to speak of my life story of hope, resilience, and redemption. And all I ask of you folks is 45 minutes of you guys' undivided attention, meaning put you guys' phones down for 45 minutes, and that's all I ask. You guys got that? During my presentation, you might hear one word. It's not a word, but an expression out of my mouth. It might sound like this. Choo! If you folks hear that out of my mouth during my presentation, that means I'm overwhelmed with happiness inside. It just comes out. Okay? You guys ready? One more time. Ooh, yes, sir. Give it up on my sweet. My name is Kyle Kilau Singh, and I golf. I love golf. If you folks come to Hawaii, I invite you guys right now to come to my home for a barbecue. Okay? Invitation is out. If you come to my home, the front yard, you look, there's an ocean. Beautiful blue majestic water with waves crashing, coconut trees float, blowing in the wind. That's my front yard. If you walk through my house and you open the back sliding door, you can see my backyard. Then you're gonna see one stone wall, 3 feet high. On the other side of that stone wall is the golf course. So I've been raised with the ocean as my front yard and the golf course in my backyard. At the age of 3 years old, my grandfather gave me a golf club for the first time. I jumped over that wall and I just started hitting a plastic ball. Yeah? By the age of 10 years old, I was a state champion in golf at 10 years old. Being a 10-year-old state champion, I qualified representing Hawaii to San Diego to play in this tournament called the Junior World Championships, where I met Eldrick Tiger Woods for the very first time. Anybody ever heard of Eldrick Tiger Woods? For those that don't know, he's a not bad golfer. So at the age of 10 years old, I representing my state of Hawaii, I grabbed my golf bag, I jumped on a plane, and I went to San Diego representing Hawaii. I had my Leon and my dad and my family. Then I seen Tiger, and I was looking at him. I told my dad, "Dad, I see him." And as a kid, we saw on TV. And I told my dad, "Nah, he don't look too, I think I got him, Dad." And he was rubbing my shoulder like this. "You got this, son, you got him." I said, "I got him." This golf tournament was a 3-day tournament. The first 2 days I was in the lead, I had a 4-stroke lead. The last day came, all the cameras came out. Ooh, everybody came out. I'm not blaming the cameras, but I didn't do as well. Guess who came first in that tournament? Tiger Woods. I came fourth. I ended up coming fourth in the world. So I jumped on a plane and I came back home to Hawaii. 10 years old, state champion, ranked 4th in the world in golf. So I sat on my wall. I came home, 10 years old, and I sat on my wall. And I'm looking into the golf course, 10 years old, state champion, ranked 4th in the world. And I'm looking into the golf course, young Kyle at 10. And I made a goal for myself sitting on that wall. And my goal was, I'm gonna beat everybody in junior golf. I'm gonna go to high school. I'm gonna beat everybody in high school. I'm going to college. I'm gonna beat everybody in college, graduate, turn pro, and buy me a mansion. That was my goal at 10 years old. I got off the wall. Boom, I set my motion for my goal. The next school day, 5 o'clock in the morning, before the sun came up, I'm sitting on my wall with my golf bag next to me, waiting for the sun to come up. As soon as the sun came up over the mountain where I could see, jump over the wall, grab my golf bag, and I started golfing. Golf, and I hit, and I golf, and I golf, and I golf, and I golf. All the way until my mom yelled, "Kyle, school!" What? Jump over the wall, put my golf bag down, grab my backpack, one motion, and I'll go to school. I just was golfing for 3 hours. Yeah, well, everybody was getting ready for school. In order for me to achieve my goal, I need to be smart in school. So I needed to stay focused to all the teachers. And focus is what I did. I was an honor roll student, and I was one of the favorites among the teachers because I paid attention. As soon as I would come home from school, I would do my homework really quick, grab my golf bag, jump over the wall, and I would golf until the sun went down. Those are my days. Golf before school, go to school, study hard. After school, golf until the sun went down. Junior golf, I beat everybody. Nobody could beat me in junior golf. Fast forward the tape, high school. Senior year of high school, 6-time state champion. 6 times I won states. My senior year of high school, I'm sitting in class. Behind me, there's a speaker on the wall. I heard this. Kyle Kilau Singh, report to the office. Oh, what? I stand up. Hey, miss, I'm going to the office, okay? She said, yeah, go ahead, boy. I was thinking, what? I'm not getting in trouble at all. Why are you going to the office? I knock on the door. I heard my principal. Come in. I walk in, I close the door behind me. In the office, I see my principal and a man that I never did see before in my life. This man didn't stand up. He said, Kyle, I watch you, your golf days, junior golf, and I'm here to offer you a full ride scholarship at our university. And he'd stick out his hand like this. And I was like, yes, sir. All that hard work I'm putting in. Yes, and shake his hand. And I said, I'll see you in 6 months. Boom. As soon as I let go of his hand, my head that is upon my shoulders got this big. Instantly. And my head got big because it got filled with ego. It got filled with sense of entitlement. It got filled with things that is not good, conceited. And I was walking around campus on different students. I just say shake the hand to one of the biggest schools in the nation. I go to school for free. 4 more years, I'm gonna graduate this university, I'm gonna turn pro, and I'm gonna buy me a mansion. 4 more years, bro. And I was walking around, yeah. And I was, the sense of entitlement got to me. And the first people that noticed my change in behavior was my teachers. And my teachers told me, Kyle, you better humble yourself. You never graduate yet. Oh, mister, tell me what to do, bro. In 4 years, I'm gonna be a millionaire. You're just gonna be still working at this school, bro. Kyle, you better watch yourself, bro. Watch yourself. I got this, bro. Walking around campus with that kind of mentality, you know. I had fair warning my whole time. Yeah, art class, Mr. So-and-so's class, had a girl in the corner that I like. I never did talk to her because I was timid. Not anymore. I walk up to her. I say, hey, hi, how's it? My name is Kyle. She said, oh, I know who you are. I said, I just need to shake the hand to one of the biggest colleges in the nation. In 4 years, I'm going to be a millionaire. Let me buy you something. That's what I thought was game at that time. The bell would ring. Ring, Mr. So-and-so, walk in. Everybody scatter, go to the chair, sit down. Not me. I'm talking to the girl I like, bro. Mr. So-and-so said, hey, Kyle, you never hit a bell. Get back to your chair. Right, can I say I'm talking to the girl? You sit down in your chair. The whole class, ooh! Fuel the fire in me. Yeah, you sit down. Shucks. This guy is so stupid, yeah? Telling me sit down. Next thing you know, he said something, I said something, his tone got high, my tone got high. I wanted to prove something to my peers. I walked back, I grabbed one piece of clay that was on the table, and I whipped him at him. And I hit him, right here. And he ran out the class. Ah! I went back to the girl. Her eyes was like this. I said, that guy is so stupid. She looked at me, she said, no, I think you're stupid. I was, what? Next thing you know, two big Hawaiian campus security guards. Big Hawaiians. I'm considered one. Medium Hawaiian. Extra, extra large Hawaiians came up to the class. Kyle, stay right there, Kyle. About two of them grabbed me by my arm like this. But you're so dumb, bro, Hawaiian. Let's go. And they're walking me out the class now. The whole class is silent. Oh, I'm scared. Took me back to the office. Get in there. Shut the door, I look in the office. My principal and the teacher looking at me. My principal tell me while shaking his head, you see that phone on my desk? I said, yeah. Pick up the phone, call somebody to pick you up because they're kicking you out. We're not tolerating this kind of behavior here at campus. What you did to Mr. So-and-so, I could actually call the police because you threw an object at him. Pick up the phone. I look at the teacher. I'm sorry, mister. There's nothing to do with you, bro. I'm sorry. I was just trying to impress the girl. He didn't really even listen to what I had to say. I go back to the principal. Principal, I'm sorry, principal. You see me shake the hand to one of the biggest colleges last week. Should have thought about that first, Kyle. Pick up the phone. Damn. Mom. Yeah, son. You gotta come pick me up, bro, from school. She said, why? What happened? You sick? You get the flu, you get the fever, you coughing, what's the matter, son? I just got kicked out, grandma. You gotta come now. What? Wait right there, son. My mom pulled into the school in her Honda Odyssey van. Pull in. I was standing outside the office. Oh, my brain going crazy. Yeah? My mom said, son, wait right here. I'm gonna walk in the office. I said, oh, my mom gonna fix this. I still going to that university. I still gonna turn pro, and I still gonna buy me a mansion. 10 minutes later, she walked out of the office, crying. Son, get in the car. I get in the car. My mom crying. I started crying because I see my mom crying. What about all those years golfing, son? All that you put into your craft. All those state championships, golfing with Tiger, your whole childhood. For nothing, son. You're so dumb, bro. And I never put my time into anything else except golf. I don't know if we'll build nothing. I don't know if we'll fix nothing. Just golf, that's all I know. And now I just got expelled from one bad choice that I made. And back home in Hawaii, you get this thing called coconut wireless, where the word traveled fast. Wow, I'd be walking in, after I got expelled, I'd be with my mom. We were in a supermarket. Old ladies would come up to me. Excuse me, Kyle. Oh yeah, hi, auntie. Oh, we heard you got kicked out. You're so dumb, boy. That's okay. Oh, okay, auntie. Bum out, I stay. Everywhere I went, people was calling me dumb. How can 200 people be wrong? So I must be dumb. Graduation came, all my friends went to the big universities, play golf. Not me. I stuck now. So my friends went change. All my golf friends that I played golf my whole life, they're all gone. And the only friends I had left was friends who was experimenting with drugs. Yeah? And the day came. My friends was offering me drugs, crystal meth, heroin, whatever drugs they had, they was offering to me. You're so dumb, bro. You're here with us now. Try this. And my mom, I could hear my mom's voice in my head telling me, son, if you ever do drugs, I'm gonna beat you up, son. So every time I'd hear my mom's voice, I'll give the pipe back. No, I don't like you be the loser. Yeah, all right, walk away, one victory. Next day at the beach, surfing with my friends. Crystal meth again. No. No, thank you. Two victories. Yeah. You only can say no so much. The day came, I was surfing. I put my surf on in the back of the truck. This crystal meth pipe came to me. I know it's fentanyl, but drugs is drugs. Categories, drugs. Boom, all of them. Fentanyl, ice, heroin. It's all on that same list. So the crystal meth pipe was in my hand now. And I did them. Just because everybody else was doing them. And I lost my ride and I won't lose them. That's how I felt. And I did them. And I was raised with love, respect, etiquette, good morals. And when I blew out that crystal meth smoke for the first time, I blew out everything that was instilled in me as a child. All my love was gone. All my integrity was gone. All my morals was gone. And I did what was necessary to fuel my addiction. And I terrorized my home of Hawaii. So now, they put me back on TV. But now it's not because I won a state championship. It's because now they labeled me Hawaii's Most Wanted. Because I did a lot of bad things in Hawaii to fuel my addiction. Because my addiction had me in a grip and had no intentions of letting me go. That's addiction. So I brought panic shame upon myself, my home, and my family. Yeah? And if you guys veer off the good path that you guys are now, or know somebody might veer off the good path that they are now, the first thing they do when you get arrested is you go to jail. That's the first step. I don't know nothing about jail. I don't know nothing about prison. I don't know nothing about nothing. But I know what happened to me. So the first thing they're going to do is they're going to get one camera. They're going to stick them in your face. They're going to take a picture. And that picture, they're going to put them on Google for the whole world to see as a mugshot. So if you guys get downtime, my name is Kyle Kilau Singh. My name starts with a Q. Just so happened I get my mugshot right here.
This is my mugshot right here. I was 29 years old, 98 pounds, full blown, crystal meth addict, Hawaii's Most Wanted. You guys believe this guy went golf against Tiger Woods, the billionaire, bro? This guy had a future brighter than the sun, bro. That's why I'm here today. My son's birthday was yesterday. I was hesitant for come to tell you the truth, because my son's birthday. But I'm here today, bro, for show you what happened to me. In hopes that you guys make the right choices or can help somebody that is going down the wrong path. You think it's easy for me to share this picture of myself? It's not, bro. But this is what crystal meth did to me, or drugs can do to you, bro. Yeah, you guys understand?
So now they put me in the Hilo jail right by my house. Across the street from the golf course is on jail. So now I ain't on jail cell. And I'm looking at 20 years in prison for all my crimes. And the first 2 weeks, all I did was eat and sleep, because there's two things that I did not do while in prison, while I was on my addiction. So 2 weeks later, I got physically strong, like this. But what was stronger was my addiction in my mouth. The crystal meth yearning addiction was strong. So I planned and executed one of the biggest escapes in Hawaii's prison so I could get crystal meth. I was in a room, a makeshift dorm, with a window way up on the ceiling, 40 feet up. I made a rope out of sheets. I lassoed a light. I went to the top. I broke the window. I jumped off the roof. I stole me the first Toyota truck I saw, and I found crystal meth. So now I had an escape. But where I gonna run? I live on an island, in a circle, like a cat chasing his tail. All of this, yeah. I wish someone would have told me this kind of stuff, bro. But addiction is addiction. So the day they caught me, 12 days later, 3 high-speed chases later, they got me again, recaptured. But this time they had different plans for me. Now my legs is shackled. There's a chain around my waist. My handcuffs is tied to my chain, my belly waist. And this is how I walk. Wherever I went, if I'm not in my cell, I walk in like this. And I instantly, because of my escape, I'm now labeled on high risk inmate. Because I'm high risk, I just plan and execute one of the biggest escapes. If you guys watch the news tonight on TV, and you see somebody kill somebody, that individual not going to a general population prison, they're going to a prison called high custody. Because they're never gonna see the light of day again. So their mentality is twisted. So they put me with them, high risk, because I was an escapee, because I was an addict. But before they put me in a high custody prison, they put me in an isolation cell AKA The Hole. You guys watch prison movies? That's real. It's called the SHU, Special Holding Unit. So I'm shackled head to toe, and they took me to a room. They took off my handcuffs on my legs, they took off all those on my hands, and they put me in a room, and they closed the door. From the door to my wall, one, two, three, touch the wall. One, two, three, touch the door. One, two, three, touch the wall. That's how long my cell was. From the wall to the door, three big steps. Every day I'll pace and pace. I couldn't see outside, no windows, no reading material, no writing material, nothing. So I waited by my trap door. Get a little door in the door. It's a trap door. The trap door open, one plate slide in. I grab my plate and I eat. And I slide my plate back out. The trap door close and I pace. One, two, three, touch the wall. One, two, three, touch the door. Next thing you know, lunchtime, same thing. Trap door open, plate slide out. I grab them, I eat, slide them back out. Lunch, pace. Dinner time, same thing. Eat, slide them out, pace. That's one day. Every week, that trap door would open, and a toilet paper roll, somebody would smash them, and a little hotel soap, like this big, would fall on the ground, and I'll pick them up. And that's my hygiene for the week. One toilet paper roll and one little soap. And I took a bath in my sink. Because I was the punk from Big Island where I live. I was Hawaii's most wanted. I had escaped fugitive. So they gave me the treatment. And all I did in that cell was pace. Like this. All day. I could see my hair growing upon my face because they never gave me a razor. My skin was losing its complexion because I never feel the sun. And I was in a bad place, bro. And I don't care who you are, you spend that much time in isolation. Things are taking a toll on your mind. And my mind is drifting to a really dark place now of depression, anxiety. I don't know if you folks can relate to that kind of feelings. But those feelings was beating me up, bro. And I believe as humans, we were created for humans to communicate with each other. And I was yearning for some kind of communication with anybody, bro. I in this 7x7 cell losing my mind. So I don't plan. The next time that trap door open, I'm gonna try to talk to whoever is that on the other side. So I'm waiting there like a dog. As soon as the breakfast food come in, I yell, hello, 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 who's out there? Shh, close, damn, peace. You alone, the voices started coming in my head, you alone, bro. Give up, nobody gonna talk to you, but you alone in this 7x7 cell. I get a new plan. Lunchtime, when that trap door open, I'm gonna try to swear. In hopes they swear at me back, just so I can hear somebody, bro. Cause I yearning for some communication. So I'm waiting again, like one dog. The trap door, I hear him open. My food come out, I swear. Swear, swear, swear! Shh, trap door close. Damn, I'm losing my mind. I'm losing my mind, bro. I am by myself. I am gonna stay here for the rest of my life. Tripping. One morning, I get up. In my 7x7 windowless cell, big beard, pale complexion. And the voices in my head are so loud, bro. The voices of depression, the voices of isolation, and the voices are yelling at me this. Kyle, you're a 6-time state champion. You was ranked 4th in the world. You golf with Tiger Woods your whole life. Look where you stand now, in a 7x7, losing your mind, bro. That's where you stay, losing your mind. Ram your head in the wall, Kyle, ram your head in the wall. That was a voice that was coming to me, bro. So I said, whoever talking to me, it sounded like a good idea. Because I was in a bad place, bro, mentally. So I back up as far as I could in my 7x7 cell, and I was ready for lunge forward, man, smash my head in the wall. But this is not how we're supposed to live. So no matter how hard I try, I couldn't go. Something was holding me back against my wall. And the only direction I could go besides forward was this way. When I was a child, yeah, nobody introduced me to God. Nobody told me about God my whole life. But I remember when I was a little child, I saw a show on TV of this guy on his knees asking this guy named God for help. I was already down on my knees. So all I said was, God, my name is Kyle. I'm sorry what I did for all those people, bro. And if you really, really out there, help me, bro. I need help. And when I said that word amen, like in a movie, amen. Boom, I felt them. One whole rush of most beautiful feeling I ever did feel in my life went flow through my body. And it's the day I got saved in a 7x7 windowless cell in Halawa Correctional Facility in Hawaii. So now I'm pacing in my 7x7 cell. I'm still in a 7x7 cell, but I'm free in my mind and in my heart. So now when I'm pacing, I'm jumping. And I'm touching the door. Yeah. Yeah. Next thing you know, I hit a door shaking. I hear keys jingling on the other side of the door. I walk back as far as I can. 3 steps back and I look in at my door. My door went open. Shoom. I saw 2 big Samoans, bro. Samoan guards, big ones. I could see only half their bodies. It was covering the whole door. Big ones. Half and half. And they was looking at me like this. I was looking at them back. Oh, I never seen a human in a while, bro. And I'm looking at them from the back of my cell. He said, come on, Kyle. Let's go. I said, where are you going? Home. He said, bruh, you far from home. Let's go. You're going to a place called the High Custody Prison. Hope you're ready, bruh. And I was looking at them like, what? Before I leave this cell, I like ask you guys something. He said, what? I said, how long I was in this cell? He said, wow, huh, Kyle. I think you set one record. You was in this cell for 3 years and 2 weeks. I instantly cry. 3 birthdays in my family, 3 Christmases, 3 Thanksgivings was all flashing through my mind. He said, come on, Kyle, let's go, bro. I just enjoyed 3 years and 2 weeks of my life in a 7x7 windowless cell. So from the back of the wall, I took 3 steps. 1, 2, 3. I usually turn, but now the door is open. So my 4th step was kind of like different, like 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and I was counting. And the guards were walking with me and said, bro, Kyle, you're right over, what are you counting for? I said, bro, I never walked in a straight line for a while, bro, like, it feels different. He said, count all you like, bro. So that was my first experience out of isolation, counting my steps going forward. So they took me to this place called High Custody Prison. And if some of you guys veer off the good path that you guys are on now, some of those choices might lead you to one predicament where I was. So now I get on a wagon. In my wagon, get my soap, on toilet paper, and on towel. And I reach the High Custody Prison. And I look into glass windows of 179 men that never gonna see the light of day again. Gang leaders, inmates with high risk. They looking at me, who this guy coming in? And they see me, big hair, big beard, tail, big eyes like this. All I see is tattoos, muscles, and no more teeth, gone. And I look in, and they looking at me like, come inside. Oh man, the door went open. The guard told me, Kyle, get in. I couldn't go. Fear froze me in my track. So he kind of nudged me. He said, get in there, bro. Boom, and I was in. The door went closed behind me. Boom. Everybody went stop and look who coming in. I look away, and I was looking for cell 9. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I left my wagon, I run in my cell. I was at the back of the wall. Next thing you know, 2 men run in, then slam the door. Boom, I look back. Too late, had a fist right in my face. Boom, I went down on my back. The second guy came above me and he stomped me like this. All my teeth, I seen them flying out. Boom, 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 boom. The teeth you see today is all fake. So that was my first experience in a high custody prison. They took my toilet paper, they took my towel, and they took my soap. But most importantly, they wanted to find out if I was on prey or if I was on predator. You guys know what they found out real quick? That I was on prayer, because I never fight back. Yeah, so every day I get beat up. Every day I was getting beat up. And if you guys fear off the good path that you guys are on now, some of those choices might lead you there. And if you guys end up going to prison, which I hope and pray you guys don't, you're going to have a cellmate with you. You don't live by yourself. And my cellmate's name was Big Bill. This man was on quadruple life, 4 life terms. Back home in Hawaii, he killed one family, tied around a coconut tree, and he set them on fire. That's who I live with. So one day, I'm done getting beat up, and I'm sitting by myself in a corner. My cell door is right here. Big Bill yelling from across the building,
"Kyle, come here, bro."
And I think it to myself. I fold my sheet, I did my bed, why he mad at me? I walk into my cell. He's waiting by the front door. He said, "Kyle, get in the cell." I went in the cell, he locked the door. He told me, "Sit down." As soon as my butt hit the bed, he had slapped me as hard as he could. Paw! My neck went whipped back, pop! And I started crying because I thought he was my friend. He said, "Look at me, look at me." I look up at him. He said, "Kyle, I cannot see these people doing this to you, bro. You want good guy? You gotta fight, bro." I told him, "I never get into a fight in my life. That's not how I was raised, bro." He said, "What? It's 7 more years with us. Bro, you gotta fight, bro." Then he slapped me one more time. Boom. Look at me. I look up at him. He said, "Kyle, remember where you stay, bro." And he opened the cell door and he left me there, my thoughts. Remember where I stay. And on high custody prison. So the next day at breakfast, the same man came to take my lunch, my breakfast every day. He came up to my table, he will grab my plate. I grab his wrist. And I said, "Not today, honey. We're gonna go to my room, cell 9, we're gonna scrap." I let him go, I went in my cell, we closed the door, and we didn't fight. My first physical altercation, and I won. I wasn't even fighting for my rights, I was fighting for my life, bro. You know the difference? So that was my first fight in prison, and wasn't my last. If you guys grew up the good path that you guys all know, some of those decisions might lead you to prison. And in prison, the guards don't run the prison. The gangs run the prison. When I went to prison, before I went to prison, my heart in my body was like y'all guys' hearts. Beautiful. And my heart was beautiful with one rose coming out. And that rose represented love. That's how I was raised. Like you guys. So one of the biggest gangs in the prison come up to me. "Kyle," I look at them, "yeah. You see that one man way in the corner of the building?" I look, I say, "Yeah, I see him." "You better go up to that man and you better hit him as hard as you can. And when he fall, you stomp him. If not, you see those three guys in the corner over there looking at you?" "Yeah, I see them. They're gonna come to your cell tonight and they're gonna get you, bro. Make the right choice." Walk away, the guy walk away. So I'm looking at that one man, he never do nothing wrong to me. And I'm looking at those three men looking at me. Sorry, bro. Make my way to that one guy, not even paying attention, hit him. Boss, step. Like that. Good job, Kyle. I saved by God. But I gotta remember why I stay in a high custody prison. I wish somebody would have told me this kind of stuff, bro. So every time I did something that was not me, I would plant weeds in my heart. Boom, boom. Now I gotta walk up to that man right there. I gotta do the same thing to him to get avoided beating up by them. Sorry, bro. Do what I gotta do, go back to my cell, cry, plant weeds. Next thing you know, the years went on. My heart was getting consumed with weeds. I was choking out the love that was in me, bro. You guys see my shirt? It says, "Stay humble prayer." You guys see my hat? It says, "Stay humble prayer." If you guys ever come to Hawaii, no matter what island you guys go to, you can see this. This is me. This is my brand. This is my business. Stay humble prayer. Stay humble prayer. So, I'm in high custody prison. I get tattoos. I know my teeth. And I get muscles, just like you. And we play cards. That's how we do. That's how we do for unwind. Yeah, we play cards. We're playing cards. Next thing you know, 6 men that never gonna see the light of day again, taking advantage of one man right here. Satisfying some needs, bro. This one man is screaming at the top of his lungs, help me, somebody help me. While 6 men do this to him. And I looking at my friend. He's looking at me like, bro, deal the cards, bro. Everybody in that facility wasn't even paying attention to what's going on. But that's normal in there. To me, that's not normal. I was raised to help. You see somebody's truck on the side of the road and they're pushing them. You push your truck on the side, you jump out and you push. That's how I was raised. You see one old lady in the supermarket getting a hard time with her groceries, you step up, auntie, I can help you. And you help, that's how I was raised. Now this man screaming at the top of his lungs for help. I never did hear a man scream like that before in my life. Remember where you stay. What if this guy did something wrong to somebody's daughter and he paying the price? Maybe this guy did something wrong to somebody's mom and he paying the price, so he let things happen. So as this guy yelling for help, I tell my friend, I'll come back, I'm gonna use the bathroom, okay? No cheat. I walk to my cell, I close my door. Stay humble, Kyle. You get 7 years left, this is temporary, this is not your home. I'm reminding myself, Father God, thank you for the breath of life. Thank you for everything that you do. Guide me, protect me, amen. Stay humble prayer, stay humble prayer, stay humble prayer, stay humble prayer. So that was my mantra that I used while in prison. Yeah, so the day came, I did 10 years of this. The guard come up to me and he said, Kyle, you're going home. I said, what, for real? You're going home. So the next day, they put me in a glass room and I'm looking outside at freedom. I know my teeth, I get muscles, and I get my whole body is tattoos. And I'm looking outside at freedom. I see the cars going back and forth, boom, boom, boom. My neck was getting sore. I see people walking on the street. I think to myself, what? I never see this in a while, bro. I see my mom's Honda Odyssey van, pull into the jail. I see my mom get out of the van. She's looking into the jail. I told the guard, hey, guard, open the door. My mom is outside. He said, Kyle, right now it's 1:58. I release you at 2 o'clock. I said, open the door, bro. My mom is outside in the sun. He told me, Kyle, you just did 10 years in prison, bro. You can't wait 120 seconds. You're right. Tell me when I can go. So I'm waiting by the front door. I see my mom in the hot sun, and I'm looking at her. Get ready. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The door crack open and run out. Mom, mom, choo. My mom, oh, excuse me, sir. Kept walking. My mom didn't even recognize me, bro. So I stopped and I said, Mom! She didn't turn around. She said, Son, is that you? She got closer to me, right in my face. And the first thing she said was, Kyle, what happened to your teeth? That was the first words, bro. I never seen my mom in years, bro. I said, my teeth is in prison, Mom. She said, what is this, all this on your body, son? She was feeling the tattoos, like trying to rub them off. She said, why you look like a scratch pad for? You look like somebody got a marker right over your body, son. I said, Mom, this is not scratch pad, this is art. I said, Mom, you know what? Let's get out of this parking lot. I said, go home. She said, yeah, you're right, jump in. I jumped in my mom's Honda Odyssey van. I closed the door, she started them up. The first thing I felt was the air conditioner vent right on my face. Boom, it hit me. When the thing hit me, I reach over and turn off the AC. My mom looked at me, son, why are you turning off the AC for? It's 85 degrees. I said, Mom, I was in AC for 10 years, bro. I didn't feel fresh air. I run on the window, boom. I stick my hand out the window, we're driving up the hill. My hand, my elbow outside, I could feel the wind on my elbow. Oh, it felt good. My head came out. My tongue came out. Going up the road, half my body out, tongue out, choo, choo, yelling up the road. My mom driving the van, son, are you okay? What are you yelling, son? Come back in the van. Son, come back in the van. Crying. First experience out of prison, halfway out yelling, enjoying freedom. Reach my house, the place where I born and raised. The first thing I did was take off my shoes and I throw them in the banana fields. I'm never gonna put those shoes on again because I'm not gonna fight, I don't need them. I take off my prison shirt and I throw them in the bushes. I walk in my mom's driveway, bareback, no more barefooted, and I walk in a circle like this with prison shots, that's all. My mom crying, son, what are you doing? I stop, I see my mom's front grass, beautiful green grass. I never did see grass in a while and it was beautiful. The color was this vibrant green. And I'm looking at the grass, my mom crying. I jump in the grass. Boom, I'm in the grass. I stand up, my toes started moving like I was playing the piano. Uncontrollably, I was moving. What? Next thing you know, and I started running. And the grass, my mom crying, son, what are you doing? Next thing you know, I felt somebody looking at me in that direction. So I stop, I turn, I look, boom, my neighbor looking at me. An old Japanese man, 90 years old, watering his bonsai trees. The water wasn't even going on the trees, it was like 10 minutes out of prison. I look at him and say, what? He didn't turn around. You guys know what I was doing? Yeah? I was feeling the grass. Each blade of grass going through my toes. Felt like I won the lottery. I'm not doing the moonwalk now, I'm feeling grass. So you guys, now you guys know the story about the grass. I'm gonna be here one more night in your guys' area. If you guys see me on the side of the road without my shirt, without my shoes, in an area of grass going like this, and whoever driving you folks around say, "Hey, look at that guy. You better not be like him because he's crazy." You guys better back me up, bro. I say, nah, he's not crazy. That's Uncle Kyle from Hawaii. And he just grateful and he's feeling the grass. Let him go. You guys can do that for me. As I wind this down, you guys doing a very good job. I'm in the process of writing two books. My first book is 101 Reasons Why I Stay Free by Kyle Kilo Singh. Number one reason why I stay free is waking up next to my wife. I tired wake up next to Big Bill. Big Bill in the middle of the night trying to hold me like on teddy bear. Oh, let me go, babe. Every morning, the choices I make today allow me to wake up next to my wife. That's the number one reason why I stay free. The choices I make. This question is for the boys. I got 1 minute left. Boys, who in here like girls? Me too, no be shame. Okay, put your hands up. Newsflash! Prison, no more girls. Just manses. So whoever had their hands up, you guys like girls that much, stay free, bro. I wish somebody would have told me this kind of stuff. Stay free just so you can be with a girl. Same with the girls. If you guys like boys, stay free so you can be with a boy. Okay? Shucks, I get so much for saying, but I only get a little bit of time. If you guys ever feel alone out there, because your mom running the streets, or your dad running the streets, or your dad in prison, your mom in prison, you guys get me now. You guys get an uncle from Hawaii. My Instagram is Stay Humble Pray. Like my hat, and like my shirt. If you guys get any questions, you guys need to talk to somebody, you guys never coming to Hawaii, message me, bro. Okay? You guys did a good job, and nothing in life is worth your freedom, bro. And being with your family. I wish someone had told me this kind of stuff, bro. But I'm here for you guys, remember that. And before I leave, I represent my home of Hawaii. I get plenty nephews, and I get plenty beautiful nieces at home, your age. And before I leave, you mind if we take a group picture? So all people in Hawaii can see, folks. I can do that for you guys. Okay, everybody, we'll try to come as close as you guys can.
Come on down, if you're at the top, come on down. We're gonna release you from there. Come on down, we're gonna give a big group picture, big selfie right up here. Oh yeah, oh heck yeah.
We need you guys to put shaka in the hair like this. Yeah? Fix your guys' hair, boy. Fix your hat, make them straight. You, fix your hair, make them nice. My nephew's gonna see you. Yeah? Yeah, there you go, boy. Shaka like this. Then I'll come down. We can take pictures on Instagram for story and stuff. Oh, there you go. So bright and beautiful, you guys look. Okay, come on. I will come down. We can take more pictures, okay? You guys ready? Shaka's up.
What? Let's give a big shout out to Flo!
All right. Hey, you guys, I know some of you have to catch buses real fast. Kyle's gonna be over here on the side. There are some cookies over here. We thank you so very much for your time. We appreciate you guys. I know John was gonna say something at the end, but I think we gotta get him out on time. John, you're good. He's like, dude, send him away. Make good choices. have a great life, and please leave feedback. The doors are over here on the exit, so there are some donuts left over if somebody still needs a donut. All right? Students, thank you so very much. Make the world a great place. Work hard, play fair, and be kind always. Thank you so much. Kyle's right over here if you want a picture.